somebody so vindictive that purpose was to destroy what I had been very precious about.
His new star was David Van Day, another 80s blonde who'd made his name with rival group Dollar.
Because he'd upset me, I was going to put a bit of fear into him and saying, you're going to regret it.
When they split, two rival Bucks Fizzes began touring Britain.
It's like a little kid with, I have nothing and I don't have a toy, I want yours.
This whole thing has been about just one person's delusion that they have an exclusive right to a business name.
The feud ranged from Butlins to the Falklands and rose all the way to the High Court as even a judge was asked to make up his mind who owned Bucks Fizz. Bucks Fizz was specially manufactured to represent the United Kingdom in the 1981 Eurovision Song Contest. Former builder Bobby G was plucked from obscurity to lead the colourful quartet. They had a catchy song and an even catchier routine for this one-off chance. And Bobby, with his co-star Mike Nolan, gave Velcro a new lease of life.
I don't think anybody really can remember where the idea for Ribbon the Skirts really came from. But it certainly was one of the best things that had happened, because more people remember the ripping off of the skirts than they do the song.
United Kingdom's entry, Bucks Fizz, very vivacious performance.
I sat there thinking, you know, we might be in the top 10 of it all.
United Kingdom, 12 points.
I never thought for one moment that we would win it.
The fanfare.
I was absolutely stunned. And I knew that this was going to change my life.
This is
Bobby.
This is Mike. That's
Jay.
And this is
good luck to them. It's Bucks Fizz.
Bucks Fizz achieved overnight stardom, but they weren't just a one-hit wonder. They went on to have three number ones and sold 50 million records. The music and the clean-cut image of the boy and girl next door appealed across the generations.
It was fantastic. I spent 10 years as a builder, not aiming towards something like that. So it wasn't something that I ever thought possible.
But it wouldn't last forever. Bobby's co-star, Mike Nolan, nearly died in a terrible coach crash. Mike eventually recovered, but the two original girls left, and the band even stopped making records. Crying. Bobby and Mike found themselves keeping the Bucks Fizz business alive on the cabaret circuit.
Now it's just me and you.
Then in 1995, after 15 years together, Mike told Bobby he'd had enough.
We used to love those days.
With Mike Nolan gone, Bobby was carrying the Bucks Fizz banner alone. His livelihood was in jeopardy.
I was a bit sort of scared, I suppose, to some degree, that I could sort of carry this forward with as much credibility.
To keep his beloved Bucks Fizz going, he needed another blonde who could pull in the crowds.
Looking for you, you are looking for me.
And Bobby thought the man, David Van Day, who'd been the lead singer of Bucks Fizz's rival, Dollar.
Out of the blue, I got a call from Bobby, and he asked me what I was up to, and then went on to say that Michael was leaving the band, and he'd been thinking about maybe having someone else in.
David Van Day had spent his riches and was now supporting his family working around the music business.
Do it again, yes, do it again, and do it nice and clear for us.
But he still dreamt of a return to the big time and his illustrious singing career, which had taken him into the top 10 five times with Dollar.
We actually came out of the punk era, and it was very hard to stand out amongst all the orange and green hair. And so I started highlighting my hair, and so it was platinum and platinum blonde colour. It was all frilly sort of shirts. And that was good, I loved that, because I used to be an actor, and I actually studied Shakespeare, and I wanted to be a Shakespearean actor.
David never played Hamlet, and never had a number one hit. But he did make his fortune as a bubblegum blonde.
This is the Dollar album, which sold buckets loads. And this is Oh L'Amour. It was a huge hit everywhere for us.
He seemed the perfect replacement for Mike Nolan.
I suppose it was felt that having another sort of face or somebody with a bit of sort of like past fame wouldn't go amiss. He looks a bit like Mike Nolan. So, to some degree, it seemed the right thing to do.
In December 1995, the two pop legends met at the Mitre Hotel in Hampton Court. David from Dollar's dream of the big time was within his grasp if he could just negotiate the right deal.
He was very relaxed and convivial, as you say. You know, we were friendly, it was fluid. I think we ordered some tea, but he was a great tea drinker. And we started discussing how we would work together, picking all the material, the costumes, my views on that, what a group should look like, what us as old as sort of gentlemen in the pop game should look like. I mean, I suppose looking back, it was like the Sunshine Boys talking about it.
It was decided they'd perform songs from both Bucks Fizz and Dollar.
There was that glimmer of hope that we'd probably maybe get a hit here. Maybe we can get a hit album.
David would give up the Dollar brand as Bucks Fizz was a bigger name and held the promise of making him a star again.
It was quite exciting, and I was really looking forward to it.
While David dreamt of the stars, Bobby was just relieved he could keep Bucks Fizz on the road. He had in his band a recognizable face and an experienced performer. But while Bucks Fizz had a reputation as squeaky clean, David had been a bit of a lad.
80s was about excess, loads of money, you know. I remember quite clearly, actually, my career sort of getting in the way of my social life. And, you know, the phone going and people saying, where are you? And I said, why? Well, so you're meant to be at Top of the Pops. And I'm thinking, gosh, what day is it? And they'd say, do you need a car? And I'd go out and say, let me look out the window, see my own car smashed up, and think, when did I do that?
There's lots about him I wasn't sort of, you know, I didn't like about him. He had a very different sort of outlook on life. But that wasn't to say I disliked. I didn't really have to like with him. I only had to sort of put up with working with him, to be honest.
In spring 1996, they were ready to hit the land of make-believe.
Shoes.
They had a number of contracts, including Butlins, where they started their venture playing to happy campers. In the deal, Bobby had his singing partner of 2 years, Heidi, and David, his singing partner, Karen.
It's 15 years of Bucks Fizz. A long, long time, and in fact, you know, Bobby, looking around out there, I think there's some people nearly as old as us. I think there may be some just a little older. Not much, but just a little.
No.
You recognise any of them?
Hey,
they're like kids.
The feeling was that everything was going okay, and that the first few shows, you know, there was no indication that anything was wrong. I thought that this would work out really well.
Bobby had taken a gamble with the band he loved, and it seemed the gamble would pay off. But after a few months, they were still just doing cabaret bookings, which suited Bobby, who didn't believe investment in the big time would pay off. But David still lusted after his land of make-believe, and there was no sign of the records, TV appearances, and hits he'd hoped for.
I felt conned and duped.
Cracks began to appear.
I could see there was problems. I could feel the pressure, the balance of power between Bobby and I. I could see he wanted to have the hand on it, and this is not what we discussed when we went into it.
To make matters worse for David, his singing partner Karen left the group. Bobby's singing partner Heidi was his girlfriend and business manager. The battle escalated.
I think it was the looks that Heidi gave Bobby to say, look, he's too. I mean, if I said, Bobby, what shirt do you want to wear tonight? You know, because we had several in hanging up ready to wear for our shows. He would go, Heidi, what should I wear tonight? And I'd go, I didn't ask her, I asked you.
He doesn't like Heidi because she used to tell him what to do. And I don't think he'll have that from any woman.
And I naturally put my authority. I didn't think anything of it. That's what I do.
A lot of it is they just wanted to be the boss. They wanted to be on top. And there's no way they would have got away with that with me. They really were control freaks. That's really what they were.
David likes wearing black.
Yeah.
Now, black, I always find, is very slimming. In middle age, you get a bit portly, all sorts of things. So, and it was very attractive.
He will wear black.
Yeah.
All day long, from the start to the finish. Well, we have costume changes, so you have to get out of that kind of feeling.
And we went to Topshop, because Topshop offers an awful lot of stuff there for cabaret, etc. It's cheap, it's cheerful, etc. And I remember them trying to open me up to all sorts of colours. I said, no, I just don't do it.
So we gave away a little bit there, and we started off in a,
black,
things like this.
And then they bought these wine red shirts. We looked like Spanish waiters in them. They were awful. And they just couldn't see it.
David felt he was being squeezed out.
We did something at a holiday camp. And there was a couple of celebrity presenters came down from a quiz show. And Bucks Fizz were part of it. And I remember at the end of it, they all went off to dinner. And they didn't invite me. And I thought, the big mistake. You know, it was deliberate. If people do things like that to me, I pay them back five times as much. It's as simple as that.
After about a year with the group, David wanted to go.
I wasn't going to let them get me before I got them, if you know what I mean. It's like, I better make a decision to go, I think.
But just as he was about to tell Bobby and Heidi, Bucks Fizz got a call to arms. Oh. 8,000 miles away, they were in demand. They'd been invited to perform for soldiers stationed in the Falklands. Bucks Fizz had been before. But David hadn't.
Yeah, I was very enthusiastic and excited about it. I heard great stories about the comradeship that you have there, and I'd had a note from an officer or something before I went out there, you know, suggesting things to do, and it was drink, he said, because it was so cheap.
From the moment they touched down, David was keen to record the highlights of the tour on his video camera.
Are we rolling? Yeah.
Yeah.
Hi. Well, we're just about to take on to Alice, and she can see her bridge wrapped up. I've been outside like this, and I'm actually still cold.
Rubber's butch, she's not dressed as much as David.
I've got to get some of these clothes off, because it's really, really warm.
We we were flown around to all the mountaintops to do shows in a Chinook aircraft, which was great fun. It was boy's own, to be honest. You know, and you kid yourself, you're a soldier as well.
There we go. We've just arrived at Mount Alice.
Hello.
Oops, oh, there we are. That's in the bar. We're at the bar. There's a bar. See you later then.
Bobby and Heidi were keen to make sure everyone got on. And Bucks Fizz made a good impression.
Everything was hunky-dory. It was absolutely fine, and certainly a few days out there we were socialising and just being totally normal.
We're looking down Mount Alice, all over the radio.
I was videoing him, he was videoing me. You know, we were having a right giggle. I was thinking, yeah, this is going to be a really good trip again. This is going to be great. It's going to be another success.
Bobby and Heidi's hopes were short-lived. To appeal to the young squaddies, Bobby decided they should sing a range of songs. None of them old dollar hits. That didn't go down well with David.
Don't think he could handle the situation he was in where he obviously wasn't being taken notice of. He was saying, I want to do my songs. They want to see me as Dollar. And we're saying, look, they don't.
Ladies and gentlemen, 70s legend, David Van Dyke!
But David did find an audience one night in the Sergeant's Mess, where he gave a solo performance of his Dollar hit, Oh, L'Amour.
Nobody knew who he was. And I think it was...
And his ego needs to be fed.
Well, I just think they just didn't like the attention I got. You know, I mean, or the way I could mix so easily. I'm very good at mixing with people, making friends and making people feel at ease.
For David, the socialising was a highlight of the tour.
Yeah, you're right, he did die.
One night, he went out with another performer and came back late and rather merry.
1 minute, Paul. Phil. And we'd be bouncing off the walls. Probably a bit inconsiderate, I might add, you know, but just having a giggle coming back. And I got this, be quiet, shut up, go to bed. And I said, Phil, what's that all about? I'm not going to have that. Come out and tell me that. Banged on his door. It was Bobby, wasn't it?
Then he's trying to kick the door down. He's trying to offer me out for a fight. He's shouting abuse and everything down the corridor.
He wouldn't come outside. I suspect he was a bit scared, and, you know, I don't blame him.
We tried just to calm all of the situation down.
And tried to salvage something out of it.
Yeah.
To finish the tour.
Bobby and Heidi tried to keep the problems quiet, but the die was cast, and things went from bad to worse.
I've never seen anybody act like this. I've never seen anyone act so unprofessional. I can cope with anything that's off stage, but to bring it on stage... I mean, I had to do routines with him. I couldn't bring myself to look at him because of it.
He wasn't doing the routines.
No.
You know, he was just sort of walking through the act.
Not really worrying what he was doing, how he was singing. He just didn't care.
That's just complete rubbish. And in fact, I would do the opposite. I would go out of my way to make sure people watch me and perform well. I want everybody to look at me then on this stage, and I'm going to show you how to perform. You're going to learn something about charisma and how these things work, you know? But if you've ever seen a movie where they're pretending to be nice to go on stage, and then they hate each other off in the wings, you know, or even side comment remarks where the audience can't see, that was all going on.
You have been watching the one, the only, Bucks Fizz!
As they left the stage on the last night, things came to a head.
We were just all in the dressing room afterwards, and I looked up and he just turned on me and wanted to know why I had this certain look on my face or whatever it was.
She'd give me another look and I'd say, what are you looking at? And
I suppose felt sorry in a way for him then and thought, how pathetic, and asked him why he was doing this, why he felt that he had to do this, and where, you know, when he had everything going for him, and he just looked at me and sort of stamped his feet and told me I had big ears.
I mean, I might have called her a lot worse things than that, to be honest.
I can only put it like childlike. That, why would a grown-up man in his 40s turn around and at the end of an argument with Heidi go, and you've got big ears? I mean, it's very immature.
And in that room, I said, well, that's it. I'm out. It's over. I'm finished working with you. It's finished, Bobby.
We saw the real side of him, though, there. That, the real side.
But whatever he was like, that was the end.
We never spoke again after that to each other. Not even in a polite way. We wouldn't speak. Probably decided I'd punish him for it, to be honest. You know, that, you know, I will now go and show them how to do this properly.
Back in Britain, they would speak to each other once more. The venue was a service station on the M6. They hoped to settle the split. But within minutes, it was clear their differences were insurmountable. David wanted to be paid for the gigs he would now not be doing, and Bobby was having none of it.
Well, I effectively sort of laughed. I mean, he was saying things that there were 40 dates in the book at that point. And he said to me, I want paying for every one of them.
If he'd said to me, right, there's 56 or 100 gigs left in, what we'd do is we'd make a deal over that. I may have taken that offer. I don't know. I'll never know. But he didn't.
He was getting so frustrated that he couldn't have his own way that he was stamping his feet, jumping up and down, banging on the table, saying, I'm going to ruin you, and making threats. There was no settlement. You can't settle with this person.
The meeting ended in acrimony.
And so I felt quite free to take my investment from that partnership elsewhere.
With David gone, if not forgotten, Bobby and Heidi decided to renew the Bucks Fizz trademark, which had just expired.
You know, he had made quite a lot of threats and stuff like that.
This should give them sole rights and stop anyone else using it for their own rewards.
We just considered it was all finished, he was gone, and we could move on to a new sort of, you know, the next thing.
All Bobby and Heidi had to do was wait for the trademark to be granted. In the meantime, the show was back on the road. There was a new singer called Graham, and the group carried on as if nothing had happened. For Bobby, the nightmare was now over. But David Van Day was planning a surprise comeback. he'd set up his own group with a particularly catchy name.
Ladies and gentlemen, Bucks Fizz!
He had coaxed Bobby's former co-star Mike Nolan back on stage to join him.
It was payback time. Good. So what?
I really did take it as a personal blow, and I felt exceptionally let down by Michael.
It was plainly obvious what Bobby felt when he found out that Mike and I were getting together. He hated the idea.
David, Van Day and Bucks Fizz. This is a new supergroup with Dolly. Do all dollars hits as
we
well.
We do all the dollar hits. You get two shows for the price of one.
With original member Mike Nolan on board, David thought his Bucks Fizz had just as much right to the name. Mike Nolan lodged an objection at the patent office. Bobby's Bucks Fizz couldn't get the trademark yet. David was free to do what he'd always wanted, to lead a revival 80s band and have fun.
There was a vibe straight away about it. And we, even with the hairstyles, you know, we both had the same hairstyles. And we walked into a room, you know, we looked like two old tarts with our hair, but people would notice us.
Oh, well, there's no posters here for you.
It was a great double act, and there was nobody in between us trying to break that up. I was jealous of it, which is exactly what I had with Bobby.
In his quest for a hit, David re-released the old Bucks Fizz favourite, with an intergalactic flavour. As well as 8 Bucks Fizz albums, all with the same tracks. The video still used the old Velcro trick.
And although we didn't do the skirt ripping routine at that time, we did this 90s thing. I felt we were in the boob age. We came up with this idea where the girls would rip these tops off and they'd have skimpy bras on underneath. And I just thought that would be a nice thing to move it on.
David's Making Your Mind Up rose to 84 in the charts. Undeterred, he set off with his new stage act.
It was far better than their act, and he hated it.
One night, they had a secret visitor, Bobby G. He was worried about the quality of David's performance and how it might affect the Bucks Fizz name.
It's very precious to me that Bucks Fizz has kept and maintained that boy and girl next door image. Coming out of that show, I was absolutely exasperated.
He felt the act didn't have the slick routines, the harmonies, and the costume changes his offered.
If people thought that that's what Bucks Fizz was, then I was lost. You know, that was my whole musical career gone.
There were now 2 Bucks Fizzes touring Britain. In one was original member Bobby G, in the other, original member Mike Nolan. With David Van Day.
If we'd done a Huey, we'd have gone back up the Uxbridge Road.
Been here before.
What, in another life?
Can I take my costume?
Would you come back as a cat? Aww.
David felt justified in his actions, not only because of Mike Nolan, but also because of one vital detail. He believed he'd had a partnership agreement with Bobby, and so both had equal claim to the name.
It was his suggestion that, why don't you become a partner with me?
I've never been in partnership with him. He wasn't offered a partnership. It's very difficult to disprove something because, you know, he will have no evidence, no proof that he was a partner with me.
Oh, well, it's clear as daylight to me. I mean, it's, you know, 100% it was a partnership.
Yeah. He 100% is lying.
There was no way Bobby and Heidi could stop David without the precious trademark. And there was no sign of it. For nearly 4 years, both Bucks Fizzes continued to perform as the dispute dragged on. And on. Then out of the blue, Bobby and Heidi got some unexpected news.
I took the call. And I spoke to Bobby and said, you'll never guess who's rang me. And he went, Michael.
I can't...
And, he knew. He just knew.
Mike Nolan and David had split up. Mike withdrew his objection to the trademark application. That meant the Bucks Fizz trademark was Bobby and Heidi's.
Michael quite clearly said, look, I want you to have the name. I know you're entitled to the name. I want you to have the name. Absolutely just, fantastic.
You can't imagine. It's five years of absolute just haven't got a clue what is going on. And then it was great, wasn't it? It really was. We can say to people now, we own the trademark. Bucks Fizz is ours. That was great for me to be able to say that. Really great.
Bobby and Heidi now thought as the Bucks Fizz trademark was protected by law, no one else could try to use the name. David was angry that Bobby and Heidi had got the trademark. And he was disappointed they didn't call him to find out what he would do now.
What his ego wouldn't allow was to pick up the phone and say, David, what's your plans? Because the ego, he can't believe that, you know, he'd have to negotiate with me. He'd rather stick needles in his eyelids.
David was determined to keep fighting, and within weeks, he had a plan.
David Van Day requires good-looking girls and boys, dynamic performers who can sing and dance.
Yes.
He was back in business.
And all look at me.
He had a new lineup, and he gave his group a brand new name.
David Van Day, Bucks Fizz!
I think the best way to describe this is if you've ever seen Terminator 2, is that every time you think that this thing is dead, it keeps getting back up, or a yep. bit of it gets back up. We was gutted, the thought that we was just going to have to start again. Because you can't let these people get away with it.
But would owning the trademark protect them against David Van Day's Bucks Fizz? It would mean going to court to find out. One night, after a concert, they took the decision to protect their business and call on the full might of the law.
I came off stage and I looked at Bobby and he just said, you know, this is what I work for, this is what I do. I can't give this up, I can't let him have a part of this because he doesn't deserve it.
We've really tried our hardest to sort of make this name into something. And for somebody to come along and think, oh, that looks good, I'll
yeah,
add that.
Yeah, that's how it feels.
That's when I decided, no, we should just carry on. Whatever it takes,
come this far.
We'll go right the way through with it and stop him.
First, they would go to the High Court to get an emergency injunction to stop David immediately. When the High Court summons arrived on his doorstep, he faced a stark choice. He could stop using the name and see the legal threat dropped, or he could fight in court for the right to keep working as he had done now for 5 years, using the Bucks Fizz name.
I thought it was probably best I come and did some of my own homework. I couldn't handle it on my own, so that's why I came down to the library to look into the books, and I looked for trademark specialists.
In July 2001, the Bucks Fizz battle reached the High Court in London. lawyers from both sides made their submissions to the judge. Bobby was waiting for the outcome on location.
It was worrying and hard. It was sitting around waiting, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And having to go on and perform as well. And he was great, I must admit. He was there, I don't know how he did it, he was there setting it up, doing the sound check, and carrying on like a right pro.
While Bobby was preparing for his concert, David sat through the hearing.
Well, I was hoping they were going to be there, because I would like to have had an eyeball. They don't intimidate me at all. Nobody intimidates me.
Finally, the judge made up his mind. There'd been two Bucks Fizzes for nearly 4 years. He refused to stop David using the name for now, pending a fuller hearing.
Yes!
And in a passing reference to the power of the Bucks Fizz brand, Justice Jacob said he didn't think there was much fizz left in the name.
To have a judge comment, you know, that I shouldn't think there's any less, I'm just poo-poo it over there. I mean, I feel absolutely, completely let down.
He just spent a lot of money on nothing. He wasted my time.
The two bands continue to perform. Now they are back where they were, locked into a costly legal battle. The only way out is if they can agree a compromise in an out-of-court settlement before the final hearing. Bobby remains confident in defending his beloved Bucks Fizz to the death.
If I gave him the name Bucks Fizz, and he said, wow, thank you very much, I'll now go and be Bucks Fizz, the public will say, it's, no, you're not.
It still wouldn't.
You are not Bucks Fizz, David.
Why should I give up a business that I spent 6 years building up to new heights, in my opinion?
David is determined to fight on.
He'll try and wear us down by dragging it out as long as he can. If I'm on my dying breath, he will not have it. I can imagine going to my grave and he'd be in the one next to it.
Oh, no.
And I can hear him going there, you've got a speed here. And then you got so everybody thinks he's a joke. You know, he has been a joke in the business all his life.
It's a ridiculous statement. Was I a joke before I went into the Bucks Fizz? Or was it Bucks Fizz that made me a joke? Ask yourself that, you know.
Terry, Devon.